Let's pray and ask the Lord's blessing and help on our next session. Father, we are burdened that there's a world in deeply in need of the gospel. And Father, we pray that you might guide us and give us wisdom and how we might join Jesus on mission in the midst of this broken and hurting world, how we might make much of Jesus and point people to the cross so they might respond by grace and through faith to the good news of that gospel. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Well, welcome back, and we've been talking some about the cultural convulsion and acceleration. We've been talking about the great sort, and we've been talking about layers of engagement and disengagement. Let me come back by talking about, so we actually, this last fall, we hosted a reunion of the Jesus People movement. Now, depending upon how old you are, you would remember some of the bands that actually came together. So we reunited the Salt Company and Second Chapter of Acts and Nancy Honeytree, and you have to be of a certain age to know those folks. But some people, the people under 30, are like, I have no idea who you're talking about. Melody Green was there. Greg Laurie spoke. I spoke. Cheryl Broderson, who's Chuck Smith's daughter, spoke. Matt Chandler and I spoke. But what was interesting was kind of hearing from the older folks there, because we were going to do this. We did this big research project. You can find it at JesusPeopleMovement.com. We did an oral history of kind of the living remainders of the Jesus People movement. And what's interesting is since we started the project in 2019, 7 of the 60 people we interviewed have since gone on to be with the Lord. So we wanted to capture their stories of how the Lord uniquely moved in the Jesus People movement. It was powerful. It was powerful. It was moving to me. But what I found interesting is how many people got up from Greg Laurie to Melody Green, that's Steve Green's widow, they got up and they said, 2020 and 2021, 2022, we did it in 2021, feels like 1968 to us. And it's at that moment when the Lord broke through in this powerful move of God called the Jesus People Movement. So I want you to hear this. This is a really challenging time to be a pastor and a member of the session or an elder. But it's in challenging times like this that we often see the Lord use his people in such powerful and impactful ways. So I don't want you to be discouraged, but I do want you to be realistic. I don't think we're halfway through the cultural convulsion that we're in. Now, things do settle down, right? But they can get worse and have gotten worse before they got better. And so we've got to have reservoirs of resilience and community of support. Barna's research said that 38% of pastors are actively considering leaving the ministry right now. So that's a pretty stunning number. It was up from the year before by 10%. We don't know historically what the trends are look like, but here's the reality. We're going to need one another. We're going to need the EPC. We're going to need your presbytery, the community that's there. You're going to need one another on the journey. We're also going to need to love, care, and be patient with one another on the journey. So if we are indeed living at this time, how do we get to this great time of tumult and turbulence? Well, in 1968, what they said there was this became a time, because the culture itself, all around us, people know it's not working. And I don't want inflation to go crazy. I mean, crazier. Too late to say I don't want to go crazy. I don't want an economic collapse. I don't want war. I don't want any of those things. But all of those things tend to really shake people at their core, and they're often accompanied by great spiritual renewal and spiritual outbreak. So if we're looking at a post-pandemic missiology, where do we go from here? And there's two kind of big themes that I want to talk about, because what for a lot of us, there were some implications of what took place in 2020. For a lot of people, we adopted almost all of you adopted a temporarily deficient ecclesiology in the emergency for the sake of the mission. Everyone said, we're gonna do different things. All of us did, we planned it out. You remember when the question was during the first 2 weeks is going to record from your church and broadcast from your church, is that an essential service? Remember people asking that question, and I actually had contacted the Surgeon General. I got in trouble with the White House because I was there for a meeting with the Surgeon General about another topic, and he came back and we talked about what they were calling the Wuhan virus at the time, so we kept in touch. And so I asked the office, is this an essential service? Pastors need to go in the first 2 weeks of shutdown. They need to go and broadcast from their locations. And I said, you know, we're going to do it, but I'm saying if you would say it's okay and it's essential service, it would be a good thing. And he said yes, and so I wrote it. I was at Christianity Today at the time. I wrote it at Christianity Today, and a lot of people saw it and used it, made some other news, and then I got in trouble. I got a call from the White House, in trouble, which is not a phrase you like to hear a lot. They said, you can't just put that on a blog. I said, well, I did ask. He says, well, but he has to go through certain channels. I said, I don't think he went through the channels, and, you know. So I edited it like 5 days later after we all recorded our services, and it was an essential service. But part of the challenge is that some of what happened was pastoral, but not theologically wise. Now, again, when I say these things, remember, because all of us get ramped up, and I know some of you think your church shouldn't have done this, or shouldn't have paused, or should have stopped sooner, or should have stayed longer. I know everyone has an opinion on this, but I'm actually not referring to that. I'm not referring to that. What I'm referring to is that pastors went into pastor mode. And pastor mode is, we got to make it okay for people. So we said, listen, the church isn't closed. It's just as good. We're going to be online, et cetera, et cetera. And in doing so, I think we persuaded some people that the physical proximate gathered community doesn't matter as much as it does. Now, some of you say, well, we should have never closed. I get that there are different views on that, and that's fine. What I'm actually talking about is not, because our church paused meeting. Almost all of your churches did. Like I said, probably everyone here did. The question of when you came back. But my point is this. Is that what we should have said, and what some did, is to say it is essential that we gather, but for this moment, we're going to adopt a temporarily deficient, this is not the way it's supposed to be, it's deficient, it's a temporarily deficient ecclesiology in the emergency for the sake of the mission. But I think now as we come out of this, there are two key things that I want to bring to you that I hope you'll receive in the spirit offered, that there are some paths forward, and then I want to get specifically how this looks like in evangelism, and they are two principles moving forward. I think we've got to elevate your ecclesiology and engage the mission. Elevate your ecclesiology and engage the mission. So let me start with elevate your ecclesiology, right? So regardless of how you articulated 2020, some people heard, and maybe you said it, right? I had pastors that I really love said it this way. You know, it's, the church never closed. No, the church did close. There was something essential that was gone. And again, I'm not saying it was a bad thing to do that, and to, you know, I think it was appropriate to pause at different times in different places. But what I'm saying is that the best way to communicate would have been something essential will be paused for a season, but we need to actually, particularly now, I think ultimately one of the things we saw is the loose bonds of the church were let go and the strong bonds of social media held on. And I think ultimately we need to push back and create strong bonds of the church, because ultimately that is the body of Christ, the community of people who have been changed by the power of the gospel, who provoke one another to love and good deeds, the writer of Hebrews says, who literally hold one another accountable in covenant community. Okay, I mean, where else are people going to be held? This is a countercultural value. So I do believe that true, full biblical community requires feet and faces, not just electrons and avatars. Now, again, I'm not against electrons and avatars. I think it's good to have additional tools. But for some people, coming out of COVID, they got so excited about the online that they've made it a goal. It's not a good goal. It's a good tool. The goal should be people in community, proximate and physical. But again, there are exceptions to that. There are persons with disabilities. There are lots of exceptions to that. But that being said, I think we've got to elevate our ecclesiology. And if I was picking a series this summer, I would be teaching some, we already picked our series this summer, but I'd be teaching some on what the church is, why it matters, and why we need to prioritize it in our lives. And the second thing is, principle coming out of this, and this is where I'm going to spend the rest of my time, is to engage the mission. Is to engage the mission. So remember the front third? Several of you at the break said that that made sense to you, and that was encouraging. So the front third, the middle third, and the back third is a key thing I like to kind of use and articulate. So the front third, the middle third, the back third. So And by the way, too, let me also say, too, that you've probably got some new people. You got a new third in the midst of that as well. When I preached at Saddleback and I explained, we had a graph. We're part of the COVID Church Tracking Attendance Research Project. And pastors tell us that there's a lot of new people in their churches, and 30% of them, according to pastors, came from their last church where they disagreed with their last church's approach to COVID. Isn't that interesting? So a third of the people. And my guess is people left your church over that, went to somebody else's church, and people are at your church who came from somebody else's church as well. So it's a pretty big shifting that's going on. Here's what I want to say. I want to encourage us to elevate our ecclesiology and engage the mission. And the third, a third, a third should help. So remember, my third, a third, a third is over here. So the front third, and you moved up some. You moved up. So there's another row of people, the more godly people, the Pentecostals are sitting over here. There you go. I see those hands. There you go. I work with the Billy Graham, you know, at the Wheaton College Billy Graham Center, so I love saying, I see that hand. You get that? You have to be a certain age, and the buses will wait if you are. Sorry. Some people are like, what are you talking about, right? Everyone under 30 is like, the buses will wait. You missed a key era of history regarding busing. It was a key part of the Billy Graham Crusade is the big buses. So a third. So here's what I want you to hear. That front third, I think, is a key moment for us. They got it, right? They're serving more and giving more. They stepped up. They stood out. They stood in the gap. They're showing the shared love of Jesus. My church has a higher percentage of people serving and sharing and that front third than ever before. The middle third is sort of hanging on, waiting, still trying to see how, you know, it's been a hard few years. The back third disconnected potentially permanently. But here's what I want to say. When it comes to engage the mission, I think that what we can do now, what I'm working towards, I'm a teaching pastor at my church, so I don't set the preaching calendar, but I speak into it. What I've encouraged our church to do is to really work hard so that we normalize the front third. In other words, what's kind of normal is the second third. There's a few people who are like super involved, but most people sort of come as consumers. They're consumers of the religious goods and services distributed by the church. And if you do it well, they like you, they come back, they like the music, they like the children's program, they like it. So we are creating customers of religious goods and services distributed at our church. Okay, that's not what we want. Well, this disruption has disrupted that pattern. Right, so the reality is the front third stepped up, stood out, and stood in the gap. I want to say to the front third, let's get the second third to look more like you and your engagement. So actually what I'm encouraging church to do is to get the front third to engage with the second third so we raise the level of engagement and involvement. Then this fall, which is a time when I think people will begin, I don't think they're coming back at the level they were before, but if we can use this fall to reach out to, it's harder to do that in summertime, depending on your geography, but this fall to reach out to the back third, which could be more than the first and second third put together because they're so infrequent attenders, and then all of us together to reach the world. But here's what I want you not to hear. I've spent the last 20 years writing about the missional church and doing podcasts and articles, angsty articles about how we've got to get people not to think of themselves as customers of religious goods and services. And in the last 2 years, a whole lot of that front third have become co-laborers in the gospel. Let's normalize that. And not, matter of fact, people say to me, what are you afraid is going to change forever? The big thing I'm actually afraid is we're actually going to go back to the way it was before, where people kind of thought of the church as this place that was there to provide and care for them solely. I think there's a place for pastoral care. I'm very pro-pastoral care. So engage the mission means that we're going to be showing and sharing the love of Jesus in powerful and impactful ways. So how might we do that? Well, many of you flew here, and you actually made it if you're here, which not everyone has made it to their flights lately. It's been quite a disaster out there in airline world. I have one daughter, and now the second daughter is going out to California to college. So I have a one-year writing sabbatical. I got to finish two books that I'm 4 years late on. Anyway, the publisher said, I'm not the worst, but I'm close to the worst ever. So there's one person who's later than me. And they won't tell me who it is, which makes me glad because that means they're not saying bad things about me behind my back either. But I'm 4 years late. So I'm getting a one-year sabbatical for my Wheaton responsibilities. I'll be in the UK teaching, and then I'm going to go out live in California to finish writing. And part of the reason is I got two daughters who now live in California, both going to college. The one goes off to Biola. You might say, well, Ed, why is she not going to Wheaton College? That's what I said to her. And she said, because we have the same last name. Ow. Small college, she doesn't want to be Ed Stetzer's daughter for the next 4 years. So we're very close, but I get it. So she's going to Biola. So I'm actually talking to the faculty of Biola in the fall just to torture her. And so that, hey, make sure you mention you saw me at the faculty meeting. But one of the things you find, it's a strange thing, flying back and forth from Chicago to LA is a fascinating thing because they put, you know, the flight used to take 3 hours. Now the airlines all added an extra like 20% to all their flight time so they can be on time. Wouldn't it be awesome if you could do that, what the airlines have done? So a three-hour flight now, they list as like a four-hour flight. And like, look, we're on time. Well, yeah, you know, avoid disappointment. Aim low. You know, it just changed your thing. But what you find is you get on a plane from Chicago to L.A., and they'll say, you know, it's going to be 3 hours, and we're going to get there early because we've got some great tailwinds. Now, tailwinds are winds that are behind. Typically, it wouldn't be going that direction. It would be headwinds that direction. But let me start with there. So headwinds are winds that are blowing at your plane, and the air, the jet stream, blowing, and it slows you down. So headwinds slow you down. Tailwinds are propelling you forward. So I think that we're right now in a season, if we're going to focus on evangelism, we have certain headwinds and tailwinds that we have to address. So remember, elevate your ecclesiology, engage the mission. The mission includes both sharing and showing the love of Jesus. I believe in both. I wrote a book on showing the love of Jesus called Subversive Kingdom. But I'm going to talk about here about sharing, because that's primarily where they wanted me to focus here, about sharing the good news of the gospel, something we're deeply passionate about at the Wheaton College Billy Graham Center. I'm a first-generation convert in my family. Most of my family are not Christians. And when I say they're not Christians, I don't mean they're in a denomination that I don't like. I mean they don't say that they're Christians. You have to sometimes be clear among people that I'm not talking about those denominations, just they're not believers. So I'm deeply concerned that we seem to be at a season when evangelism, the only time people are talking about evangelism nowadays is when they're making fun of how people used to do it. And I would say something D.L. Moody once said, I like my way of doing evangelism better than your way of not doing evangelism. So this really matters to me. You know, when I serve at the Wheaton College Billy Graham Center, and I was the interim pastor of the Moody Church, both named after evangelists, this deeply matters to me. Now, the cultural moment matters to me because it impacts us. So I'm a missiologist. My PhD's in mission. Missions is understanding people before you tell them, but missions is deeply tied to evangelism, which is telling them. So I've tried to help you understand the cultural moment as best I could in the short time that we had, and now I want to talk about telling them in the midst of the cultural moment. So let's first look at some of the headwinds coming out of COVID. Headwinds coming out of COVID. One of them I've already talked about. I didn't call it this, but it's called shrinking nominalism. So I don't know if you saw, but now we're down to 81% of Americans, just this last week, 81% of Americans believe in God. It's declining precipitously. The percentage of people who are Christian is declining, who call themselves Christian, is declining 1% to 2% per year. So what's happening is the percentage of people who are devoutly religious in this country actually has remained relatively steady. You got to listen to my keywords, devoutly religious. So it has remained relatively steady for a few decades, right? So that would include mostly evangelicals. More than half of the devoutly religious people in the country are evangelicals, but that includes Catholics, that includes Mormons, that includes people of other religions as well. And again, to be clear, I'm not making a theological statement. I'm saying they're devoutly religious. So that has not declined precipitously. What's declining precipitously is people who are a little bit religious, or use the word Christian to describe and define themselves, and it's not that important to them. They are dropping the label like crazy. But not only are they dropping the label, they're dropping their openness to the conversation to some level. Now, still, the majority, I'm going to show you, there's a lot of openness still that's there, but nominalism, people are Christians in name only. Most of our evangelistic outreach is geared towards people who already say that they're Christians. Now, that's a very strange thing. I was actually talking to a Jewish religion reporter, and she said to me, you know, like, I forget the time, she's like, 75% of Americans are Christians. Why do you Christians always sound like there's so few of you? And I said to her, I said, well, we actually don't believe that they're all Christians. And she said, well, if they said they're all Jewish, I'd believe them. Why don't you believe them? It's a fair thing. And I remember explaining and how strange it sounded coming out of our mouth. So I said, well, a big part of evangelism is convincing people who think they're Christians that they're not actually Christians so they can become Christians. And she said, really? I said, yeah. And you know it's true, right? Most of the people that you have seen come to Christ in your church the last 10 years are people who already used the word Christian to describe themselves before they were. If they filled out a form, they say the word Christian on it. So that percentage is shrinking, and what's replacing it is people of other religions or people who are secular, not generally atheists. So there's certainly atheism is a growing thing. But here's the weird thing. Most people who don't believe in God don't call themselves atheists. Interesting, because people don't like atheists. I mean, statistically. I'm not saying you don't have to. I'm just saying statistically, it's like people didn't like, if you do polls, people don't like them. So a lot of people will kind of stay away from that label. But the reality is, we're going to have a harder time sharing the gospel. And this is why I was very enthusiastic about your engaging the three circles. So Jimmy Scroggins has been a dear friend for a long time, done things at his church. And I think the three circles helps to frame the conversation in a way that we didn't have to. So when I came to Christ, I got in trouble as a teenager, as a youth group age kid. And my mother, who was a brand new believer, punished me by sending me to youth camp, which I will tell you, if you're a youth pastor, that's really what you want, is a bunch of kids who got grounded and had to go to youth camp. Because nothing says it's going to be a great week than a bunch of people who this is their punishment. So my mother sent me to this camp. But I heard the gospel there, and I responded by grace and through faith. I was born again that day, little youth camp. I took my daughter to there just to see. I said, Caitlin, that's right. That's where I trusted Jesus. And they said, the first thing I still remember the person who it was a band, and First Love was the name of the band. You never heard of it. It was just a little local church thing. And then they said, you should go home and tell someone who's not a Christian that you've become a Christian. And that's really a great practice, by the way, because what it does is it cements evangelism early on. But I didn't know the words, I didn't know language. So I went home to my dad and I said, Dad, are you saved? And that's the word they use. Now I'm saved, I'm born again. So I said, Dad, are you saved? And my dad said, saved from what? And I said, I have no idea, but I just was, and you need to be. That was my first evangelistic encounter. Now, where I grew up on Long Island, and we were nominally Catholic. The Catholic Church was the church we didn't go to on Sundays. But I knew God wrote a book. I just didn't think I could understand it. I knew that there was a God, I just didn't think I could know him personally. And when someone told me, I was ready to go from, okay, wait, so the Bible says that I'm a sinner and I'm in need of God's grace. It's right there in the Bible, I have respect for the Bible. I've seen the priest hold the Bible or read from the Bible. It says Jesus says I need to be born again. Okay, I want to listen to Jesus. And so, but here's the thing, all of the predecessor facts there, all that pre-existing information, doesn't exist for people who aren't nominal Christians, and increasingly doesn't exist for people who are nominal Christians. So as we enter into more of a secular age, a post-Christendom age, it's harder because, I mean, I even see some of our evangelism training, which is basically telling people, you know, you can be born again. Well, what does it even mean to be born again? What does it mean? So for my family, most of the issue for them is not that they think God is good, is they don't understand why Jesus had to die on the cross for their sin and in their place, and they have to receive by grace and through faith his work on the cross on their behalf through his resurrection and victory over sin, death, and hell and the grave. So again, people are starting a different place, and nominalism is a key. The shrinking percentage of nominal is a big thing, but that's not the only one. Let's keep walking through. Shrinking nominalism, and we go from there to attitude towards proselytizing. So proselytizing is the generic word. We use the word evangelism, but evangelism is a Christian word, evangel, even though the business world has adopted evangelism, by the way. You know, Apple has an evangelist. Starbucks has an evangelist. They actually hire evangelists. There's titles in their name called evangelists, which I think is fascinating because I think a lot of, if you've gone back 30 years ago, some of the people in the church have all moved away from the term evangelist. Partly because of the language, but the world has adopted that term. Maybe we need to remind ourselves that the good news of the gospel being shared. You're the Evangelical Presbyterian Church, and the heart of that is the evangel, the good news of the gospel. So let me just say, too, as someone who works at the Billy Graham Center, used to be the interim at Moody Church, I once got in front of Moody Church, and I said, listen, we got to up our evangelism. We got to either change our name or change our ways. I'm going to tell you, as Evangelical Presbyterian Church, the evangel being at the core of what you do, you've got to make sure that value is reflected. That name matters. And I recognize that name has some baggage. We're going to specifically talk about that in a minute. But evangelism has fallen on hard times. People are okay with you being religious. It's you trying to encourage them to switch religions or to become religious, using the term that they might use, is the problem. People are anti-proselytization. They're anti-evangelism in this age. And here we find ourselves. We need to keep moving forward. Accelerating cultural shifts, right? So we are now, by the world standard, on the wrong side of a lot of cultural issues by the world standard. So it's not just that, now mind you, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, that wasn't the case, but today we find ourselves on the other side of the cultural divide, particularly from people who are not Christians, because it's only a smaller and smaller percentage of people, and there's cost to that, right? So I don't know if they have repealed Roe v. Wade, not, I've been with you, but I'm not sure if it's released today. But you'll see my article in USA Today, what it means now, being thankful. I was speaking with gratitude of the repeal of Roe v. Wade and the work that we have to do moving forward as followers of Jesus. I know a lot of people who don't follow Jesus are going to be bothered by that. And we walk kind of a tricky line, right? So accelerating cultural shifts puts us on, from the world standards, the world side, but we need to speak up for what's right. And in this case, it's the unborn. We need to speak up for what's right on other issues as well. So it becomes a challenge. How do you do that? I'm going to talk about how to, because there's some tailwinds that are going to help us. The fourth headwind is the image of evangelicalism. The image of evangelicalism. Again, you're the Evangelical Presbyterian Church, and I know that you've had people in your church or in your community say, is evangelical the right word to describe ourselves? It's been a tricky time. It's been a tricky time because, and some of it's because of things evangelicals have done or maybe who we are. Some of it's because of an unfair presentation of who we are in multiple contexts. It's a mix of all of those things. But here's the thing. At the end of the day, Christians have had bad reputations on and off for 2,000 years, and the gospel is still advanced. Now, the reality is you might find that there are places that that you're not invited. You might find relationships that are difficult to maintain. But this is where our fidelity and faithfulness to the gospel is necessary in the midst of this. But also, too, we should address some of the issues inside of our movement as well. I've tried to do that. You may not always agree with the ways that I've done, but I've tried to do that as well. So one of the things I want to let you know about, too, is we actually think that this moment we're in, one way through is, I think there are two main ways through. Point people to Jesus and help people to really rightly see Jesus followers. Because my guess is your neighbor, let's say you got a neighbor who's really anti-Christian, they're probably not anti you. I mean, unless you've been a bad neighbor. But my guess is they barred your lawnmower and you built some sort of relationship, things of that sort. So it's like in my case, I have a congressman. My congressman in my district is part of the coalition that wants to defund Christian colleges, you know, so very much different than me on all major social issues. And yet I've befriended him. We're friends. And in the midst of that, he'll say, well, you're not like so and so. So I said, you know, I believe the same thing that they believe. Said, we don't seem angry about it all the time. And what I said, I don't think they're as angry as you think they are. I think you're reading into some of those things. So what happens is, I think pointing people to Jesus and seeing individual relationships with Christians is going to be key. It might be harder to invite them to church because the church's reputation may suffer, but pointing people to Jesus and more. So I'm actually, I'll give you a little backstory. Some Christian business leaders have actually decided that they want to help start and foster a conversation about who Jesus is, pointing people to Jesus, and then hopefully their Christian friends will continue the conversation with them. And there have been ads. It's the largest faith-based media campaign in history. Some of you remember the Mormons did this thing, I'm a Mormon, and millions of dollars. And the Methodists did this thing, you know, open hearts and open minds, and millions of dollars. But never has an evangelical group done that, because who does it? Like, is it, you know, does the EPC do this, or does the you know, Assemblies of God or the Southern Baptist do this? Well, some business leaders said, we're going to put $150 million a year into getting a conversation started about Jesus. And this is called He Gets Us. And this, I'm one of the national spokespersons. Go ahead and go to the next slide. So it's called He Gets Us. And it's all these ads. I just had a interest. How many of you have seen a He Gets Us ad? Oh, yeah. Okay. Lots of you. Okay. So, and I'm going to work with some of your leaders. We may do a briefing on this because the business leaders got way ahead of the Christian ecosystem, and in the sense, and not in a bad sense, but in the sense that they were decided about, they started running ads, and now we're trying to help churches sort of catch up and create strategies around this, because people are talking about Jesus. Here's why. What we found in our research is that the vast majority of Americans, even those who don't go to church, even those who are hostile to church, tend to have a positive impression or perception of Jesus. Now, don't miss this. We all know they make Jesus in their own image. Everybody makes Jesus in their own image. We need to get, but here's the thing. If I'm right, that key pointing forward is going to be pointing people to Jesus and to Christians. Those Christians, if trained and engaged, can help foster conversations around the water cooler or in the homeowners association and more. So people are talking about, how does Jesus get us? How do we understand Jesus? Well, guess what? Jesus came, died on the cross for our sin. Point them to the good news of the gospel with Christians who love and care for them as well. So if you sign up for the notes, which again I share with you, you go to hegetsuspartners.com/EPA, you'll actually get an email that explains how your church can get engaged and involved. Because I think pointing people to Jesus and engaging them with someone that they care and know as a friend makes a difference. So let's go to the tailwinds, because I think I want to point us to the good news. This is a tailwind. Right now we have Christian business leaders who, without anybody's permission, went ahead and decided to invest hundreds of millions of dollars to get people talking about Jesus. Let's go. So, because some of you are old enough to remember, because I still remember this. So my family's not a Christian, mostly not Christian. I remember making fun of the last time there was a big campaign like this, and it was I Found It. How many old enough to remember Campus Crusades, I Found It? Yeah, sure. So like we were non-Christians, and my dad had this funny line, because there were these bumper stickers all over in New York, said, I Found It. And my dad I Found It, and I got it all over my shirt. And for some reason, I just remember that. So I literally remember, but here's the difference. There was nobody to tell us what it meant. Well, here with He Gets Us, there's a website. If you go to hegetsus.com, that's non-Christian facing. Hegetsuspartners.com, that's more you facing. But there are tailwinds, and one of them is this great spiritual hunger. I've sensed like I've never sensed before. I was actually talking to Matt Chandler. He's a student in one of our programs, in our grad program at Wheaton, finishing his master's degree. And we were just talking. He said, Ed, I've never seen more spiritually hungry people who've looked at the world, said, the world has failed. I need something eternal. And I see that all over the place. I see that when my kids bring their friends over. I see that in the next generation, which I'm going to unpack some in just a minute. I see that in the next generation. And where they're in broken homes and fatherless and unsure about the future and COVID's taken such a toll, and I've had the privilege to sit down and pray with them and share the good news of the gospel with them. There's a spiritual hunger that's out there. The world's on fire, and it's an opportunity for us to show and share the love of Jesus. The failure of the modern experiment, I've already touched on this, but it's not working, sisters and brothers. The world, the center is not holding. If 10 years ago you thought we're just going to keep going, things are going to get better and better and better, it's not. And I think that points people to the reality of the deep need of Jesus. I think the deployment for mission. I love the fact that right now, the front 30 of your church is more engaged and more involved. I wouldn't have thought that 2 years ago. But they've stepped up, they stepped out, they stood in the gap, and it's an opportunity for us to invite them. And I think the tumult and the opportunity that we have before us is obvious. The tumult that we have before us is obvious. It's tumult and opportunity. Again, if we're living through a cultural convulsion, in 1968, we got the Jesus People movement. Last time it happened before that was late 1800s, and we got the Pentecostal movement, right? So Pentecostal movement kind of bubbles out, the Welsh Revival and the Pentecostal movement sort of bubbles out of the cultural convulsion of the late 1800s. We can point to the Second Great Awakening related to the cultural convulsion of the mid-1800s. I mean, over and over again, but it's not going to be easy. We're going to need each other, support communities. We're going to need reservoirs of resilience. If you as a pastor or church leader find yourself struggling and unable to push through some of these, it might be time to say, let's support one another with mental health community options as well. We can find that path forward. Again, I love the phrase in Esther 4:14, perhaps you've come to this role, to this position for such a time as this. So where do we go from here? How do we engage the next generation? I just want to touch on a couple things. So let's put up here on the screen some generational charts. So you can see Gen X, Millennial, and Gen Z are two generations that we're talking about here. And again, it's not, I recognize, sometimes when I ask this, people feel, I'm not shaming anybody that we're in an older congregational setting, because people who are older tend to come to meetings like this. When we go to the NAE board meeting, it's going to be older leaders, because that's who tends to come to this. But how many of you are a baby boomer or older? Would you raise your hand for just a second? Okay, so that's the vast majority, right? Okay. All right, I'm a Gen Xer, so how many of you are Gen Xers? Okay, okay. Woo, woo, yeah. No one pays attention to us, so we might as well say woo in a meeting. Oh, we're millennial. But how many of you are millennials? Raise your hand for just a second. Okay, a bunch of you millennials, okay. And then Gen Z, how many are Gen Z? Okay. Yeah, we take it. Yeah, we like them, yeah. So my friend Rick Richardson wrote a book called You Found Me, looking about how we were engaging younger generations. And these numbers have actually shifted some since the book was out. But let me share with you some quick takes on Gen Z, because I talked about sex and gender. Let's take a look. In Gen Z, 16%, now it's actually up to 20, over 20 now, 16% identify as LGBT, 59% say application forms ought to have more gender options than man or woman, and 28% by age 17 have experienced sexual abuse. It's a very different world than particularly those of you who grew up in a church world and a church context. And as the father of Gen Zs, you can actually see and walk through with some of the Christian kids, I'm not sure how to respond to this, and I don't think the generation before me has given me the tools or the knowledge or even has the understanding of how to help me to respond. So I want to encourage you to acknowledge, we can talk about 50 other subjects, I'm just touching on a few key issues. I really want to encourage you to take some time to recognize how much the world has changed. Look at Gen Z, and when it comes to issues of race, we're actually soon to the point where the majority of people will be minority. So we live in a minority-majority world. And so, key thing, and I also say too, in Rick's book, Rick's on my team there, I wrote the foreword to the book, it's a Billy Graham Center research project. We think a better name for the nuns is the unaffiliated, just people who aren't affiliated or aren't connected, but the nuns are the none of the aboves. People don't have any religion, when they answer a question, they don't say Christian or Jewish or Hindu, there's none or nothing. So in Gen Z, in 2020, Gen Z are 45% nuns. 45% nuns. It's pretty stunning. 7% atheists, 6% agnostics, 31% nothing in particular, and 35% Christian. So pretty fascinating how big the shift is before us. Actually, you can actually look at the nuns who think the Christian faith is harmful to society is actually, you might find, is not as high as you might expect. So only among atheistic nuns, only 43% think it's harmful to society. Among agnostic nuns, 21%. But the vast majority, only 3% of people think that. So I'm kind of the view, and we're going to have a Q&A. I think we have almost an hour of Q&A. We're going to have a Q&A, and I might unpack some of this at the beginning of that Q&A. But I think we're at a season when we look at these numbers, and we could say, I'm not sure how to engage this generation. And what I would say is, I'll talk some about this in the Q&A, is just beginning the relationship is going to be key. Help equipping Christian young adults to engage in those contexts as well. But I want you to take a look at this as kind of my last slide. And this is actually receptivity. We asked the nuns, these are not all Americans, these are the nuns. If a friend of mine really values their faith, I don't mind them talking about it. If a friend of mine, and again, show them the next slide too. I'm going to not get to all these slides, but all the slides are at, you can download the whole deck. I just didn't finish everything. If you go to hegetsuspartners.com/EPC. But this one here, I asked, which of the following would make you more interested in listening to what Christians had to say? So here's the thing that I hope you heard. I'm going to say one last time, and then we'll take our break, and then we'll come back with a Q&A. There are things, and there are ways we can be as followers of Jesus that help people to have a greater hearing and a greater openness to the gospel. I saw them treat others because of their faith. I saw them caring for people's needs because of their faith. And I don't know about you, but in the last few years, I've seen all kinds of Christians do all kinds of these things. Some more than I've seen them ever before. The front third has stepped up. And so if the world's in the midst of this tumult and turbulence, go ahead and go back to the slide about receptivity. And we actually have 75% agree, somewhat or strongly, that if a friend of mine really values their faith, I don't mind them talking about it. If we're going to engage in the good news of the gospel in the next few years, remember I said pointing people to Jesus, and that's part of what we're doing, the He Gets Us campaign. So you got hundreds of millions of dollars so that people are talking about Jesus all over the country. But then you've got tens of millions of Christians who, if they've been changed by the power of the gospel and living out its truths, are the kind of people that we want to be representing Jesus and His kingdom in the midst of a broken and hurting world. And the nuns themselves, nuns, none of the aboves, people who have no religious identification or affiliation, they say, I don't mind people sharing my faith. Now, here's the reality. I think we're talking ourselves out of evangelizing an entire generation because we aren't listening to the fact that they're actually open to hear the good news of the gospel. So I'm going to close with a word of prayer, and then we're going to come back. I'll do a little bit more at the beginning of the Q&A because I want to touch on a few other things, but I don't want to keep going longer in these sessions because Brad will get mad at us. You don't want the Brad. So let me pray. Lord, thank you for your people, the churches and the leaders here at the Evangelical Presbyterian Church. Thank you for the privilege I have to share with them. Thank you for the openness that they gave me to listen through some controversial things, but to try to understand this cultural moment. Lord, in the midst of a convoluted and convulsed time, may, as we've talked about here, may we be focused on showing and sharing the love of Jesus. May our heart for the evangel, the heart of the Evangelical Presbyterian Church, the evangel, be evident as we share the good news of the gospel in the midst of a broken and hurting world. For it's in Jesus' name and for his sake we pray. Amen and amen.